see the writing on the wall. The problem lives in what I see. Her separate him outside, her separate me. In a desert land.
Hello, my name is Sylvia Pierce, and I'm doing a series, and actually I'm in lesson number 9. And this series is Romans 5 through 8, and I hope you're following with us in this exciting series. We're getting ready to the very climax of the whole thing, finding out why the human, the Christian, is so accused all the time and feels so condemned about himself and believes it himself to be just a rotten son of a gun. Do you know what? My husband used to say that about himself. I'm just a no good rotten son of a gun. And I used to say, honey, that's not who you are. But as long as he thought that's who he was, that's how he walked out. That's what he walked out. And he acted as if he were a flesh person when he was really a spirit person. And that's what this is about, is realizing the difference between living in my flesh, which is constantly under condemnation, sin consciousness, me conscious, condemnation, guilt, and trying to always improve myself. So therefore, that's why I live accused all the time. And some time ago, I was looking in the book of Revelations, actually in chapter 12, where it talks about Satan. And I just want to turn there for a minute to do a little sidestep, not very long, because nobody likes it when I take too long of a sidestep. But I will. I'm going to go to Revelations chapter 12. And we're going to look at a very interesting scripture talking about Satan. It's in, starting with verse 9. It says, "The great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceives the whole world." See, we're still talking about a deceived mentality in Romans 7. And Paul's coming to the truth. And he's dropping off the deceptions. But Satan has actually deceived the whole world. Deception means he makes you to believe a lie to be the truth. That's what deception is. And he was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, "Now is salvation come, and strength in the kingdom of our God, and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast out." Now look at this statement. "Which accused them before our God day and night." Just think about that a minute. Let's just think about that picture. A heavenly picture. And I'm going to speak as if, you know, we're all separate men. So, and I have to say this so that we can, you know, have some kind of understanding of what I'm trying to say. Picture God the Father sitting, Jesus Christ sitting at his right hand, and God the Father turned the opposite direction. And Jesus sitting at his right hand, God the Father turned towards the left. Jesus putting his hand on God the Father's leg, and he's also looking the opposite way. And behind them is Satan accusing the brethren day and night before the very throne of God. What a picture. Why doesn't God the Father do anything? Why doesn't Jesus the Son do anything? Why do they let Satan? They finally kicked him out. Okay, that's right, they did. But think about this picture. Now, why is Jesus not doing anything? Because Jesus has already done it all. He's already done it all at the cross. And so Satan is accusing the brethren, and Jesus does nothing but put his hand on the Father, because he's saying, "Father, I've accomplished it." The Father knows Jesus has accomplished it. And so they wait. What are they waiting for? They're waiting for us to answer back to the accusing finger of Satan. How do I know that? Look at the next, because this is a picture of Satan accusing us, because the throne of God is inside of us, and he is accusing us day and night before the Father. Now, what is the answer? The answer is in verse 11. This is a very well-known scripture, but do we ever think of it this way? It says this, "And they overcame him," that means Satan, "by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto death." They overcame him. God the Father, God the Son is waiting for us to agree by the Holy Spirit, with the Holy Spirit in us, to agree that Satan is already defeated and has no rights to my humanity. My humanity belongs to Jesus Christ. Yet, he accuses my humanity day and night, and he does it inside of you. He does it inside of us all the time. And we take it as if it's our own voice. We think the voice that we hear, this accusing voice, is me accusing me. It's me hating me. When it's really the voice of the accuser, anytime you hear with inside yourself anything, downward, 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 always accusing, that is Satan talking. He is speaking to you in first person. Okay, now, how is this overcome? And how, what did Paul do when he looked at verse 17? And we're going to look at verse 17 because verse 17 reveals who the culprit really is. It's exciting, isn't it? Okay, let's read 17 and 18. "Now then, it is no more I," the human being, Paul, the human being, "that do it, that does the sinning, but sin that dwells in me." It's no more I that do it, meaning there's no more I that does the sinning, but there is sin that indwells me. Sin indwells me. What did we say when we first began this series, that S-I-N was really a noun? It was not the verb. It was not the fruit, but it was the very root. Okay, Paul is saying that, "For I know that in me, in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good, I find not." That's where every weary Christian comes. This is the commentary on it. This is a vital revelation. Something wholly other than Paul was doing the sinning. Yet, the other is accusing Paul of being the evil culprit. That is an amazing discovery. No more I that do it. The human Paul wasn't producing his own sins. The truth is that the human vessel is totally incapable of producing sins. Big news! Were we capable of producing righteousness? Why do we think we're capable of producing sins? Okay. Only a deity nature can produce sin or righteousness. The human being doesn't have its own nature, so therefore it has no power to produce sin or no power to get free of it. So it's powerless. See, we thought we were the ones producing the sins. We were the ones that should have the power to conquer it. This passage is the negative counterpart to Galatians 2:20. Now, why do I say that? Here is the proof that the human never had its own nature. Galatians 2:20 says, "I am crucified with Christ." It says, "I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me." So it's not the human I living at all. It's the human I that's the vessel that's expressing the life of another. Okay, so we know, and most Christians do, that they're not their own righteousness. They contain Mr. Righteousness, who produces the righteousness through us. Romans 7 says the opposite, though, the negative counterpart. It says, "No more I that does it, but sin that dwells in me." There it is. The human cannot produce its own righteousness, Galatians 2:20, nor can it produce its own sins, Romans 7:17. The human is a simple vessel. The human is a simple vessel. then who is it producing the sins? And what or who is sin? The sin that dwells in him was disguising the sin that dwelled in him was disguised as self-effort, as him having his own power, his own self-effort, his own independent self. Sins are the fruit product of the producer of Mr. Sin. And everyone knows that fruit doesn't have power in itself to produce, to bring forth itself. Jesus said in John 15 that without me, the vine, you cannot produce your own fruit. Therefore, sins must be the product of a person called sin or Satan. 1 John 3:8 says, he that commits sin is of the devil, because it is the devil that sins from the beginning. If the human can produce its own sins, then there is a strong possibility that it will be able to produce its own righteousness. That is blasphemy, because the human would then take Christ's place as Savior and be his own Savior. See, if you produce 1 ounce of sin in and of yourself, now that's what Satan accuses you of, but if you can do that, and you have the power to produce sin, there's a strong possibility that you have the power to produce your own righteousness. You wouldn't need a Savior then. You see the dilemma here? See how important it is to see that the human being is a simple container of the life of another. And if I don't know that, and if I'm not living by that, and I'm not functioning by that, and that's not a living reality to me, I'm living as if the vessel is an independent self and has its own power, its own strength. It's the lie, the old lie of the universe. The same lie that Satan said when he said, I, the creation, will be like the Creator, the Most High God. I'm going to be like him. I'm going to be higher than him. You see, that's what we Christians, that's what Satan is really feeding us Christians, and we're believing it as the truth when it absolutely is a lie. The creation can do nothing but contain the Creator and express the one who lives in him. And yet the accuser accuses the human being day and night before the throne of God, and God says nothing because he's waiting for us to overcome him. How? By the word of our testimony. What's our testimony? What God says is true. What God says is true is the truth. Not what you think, not what you feel, not what others tell you, but what God says is true. That is the truth. And God the Father, God the Son is waiting for you to just simply agree with what he says about you. And as you do, that overcomes that one in you who accuses you day and night. And guess what? He's kicked out of your heaven too. And he no longer can accuse you. He's kicked out to this world where he doesn't belong inside. You say to yourself, how in the world did Satan get inside me in the first place? Now, number one, he's not in your spirit. We're going to have a chart come up maybe the next time that shows that we're really tripartite being. We're spirit, soul, and body. Now, Christ is joined to us in our spirit. Satan only attacks us from the outside. But he is speaking to us in our minds, and our mind, our thought, and our reasoning power is all in our soul level. So it's like he's not really in us, but he's in our flesh realm. That's where he is. I like to say he's on you. He's not really in you, because in you would be in your spirit. He's not there, but he's certainly working in your flesh because you believe the reality that you're an independent, you're agreeing with him. We Christians agree with Satan more than we agree with God. We agree that we are independent, that we should and ought to not covet and not do bad things. We do agree with that is true. But then how to do it? That's the question. How to do it? It certainly is not by me trying to rise up and conquer my own sins and my own temptations. It's simply by faith. Everything we have in Jesus Christ is by faith. And we have to take it by faith. This really is a very radical time. This is a radical place in Paul's life, and it's a radical place in your life, because we have to be pressed in a most radical way to the place where we are so desperate. I was there sitting in my closet beating my head on the wall. Either I had to have an answer or I was going to die because I could not live any longer the way I was living. You see, most Christians don't even care that much. They want to hide their sins and act like they're okay. Well, okay, until God presses you, and it's up to God to press you, and He will do it. He'll take you to your own desperate place. He'll take you to your own corner, wherever it is, or your own closet, or your own addiction, or whatever it is that besets you as a Christian. He'll take you to the end, because in that crisis will come your word of faith. That's when it's going to come. That's when it's going to mean most to you, because you're going to have to say what God says about you or die. And that's exactly what Paul had to do. In Arabia, he had to say what the truth was about himself or live in that desert place the rest of his life. And that's what most theologians, most teachers are telling us today, is that that's the best we can have as Christians. We have to live in that desert place of trying and failing, because the best thing I can do is try as hard as I can, because if I try, the more I try, the more I'll possibly get to some kind of victorious place. That is the biggest lie of the universe, that the human can produce its own righteousness. That is a lie. That's Satan's lie. We're hearing more lies than we are truth. I can't help it. I get riled up. Sorry. All right, let's read it. Therefore, sin must be the product of a person called Mr. Sin or Satan. And then 1 John 3:8 says that he that commits sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. If the human can produce 1 ounce of its own sin, we read this before, He's able to produce righteousness, and he becomes his own savior. And we don't need a savior. That's what the devil's plan is to absolutely trap us so that we think, you know, we can either produce righteousness or sin in and of ourselves. And the Bible says absolutely both are evil and wrong. And that's eating from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil and not eating from the tree of life. Jesus said, eat my flesh, drink my blood, and you'll live forever. That he is the tree of life. We better be eating off of what he says, and confessing what he says to be true, and calling God the truth, and not saying that God is a liar and what I think is the truth. And that's exactly how we live. We would be our own God and fall right under Satan's devious plan for man to become like God. That is, the creature to become the creator, and for fallen flesh to try to become divine spirit, which would make man the son of Satan instead of the son of God. You know what? We Christians are so worried about New Age teaching. We're more New Age than the New Age. You know why? Because it's more serious for us, because we're calling ourselves Christians. But yet, as long as you're believing in your own humanity to rise up and become something, you're into humanism. Humanism is the baby sister to the New Age. And you know what? I was watching a show on Oprah Winfrey, I don't know, about 10 years ago. It was the priest of Satan coming, and she was interviewing him. And she asked him a very interesting question. She said, do you believe that the New Age teaching is really Satan teaching, or is it satanic? Is what you teach being in the Satan church? He said, oh yes, they don't realize it, but it absolutely is. Well, I'm going a step further, and I'm saying Christians who believe in their own human abilities is the most devious of all New Age lies, and it's coming straight from the pit, because the flesh is weak and never, never, never meant to produce its own righteousness nor sins. Now, can you see that we can finally get off our flesh and onto the real truth of who we are? Can we see that? Can we see the lie that's been dished to us by other people, by Satan, but basically from Satan himself? Because we don't really war against flesh and blood. We're warring against principalities and powers. And he's trying to make us believe this lie so that he can stumble us and keep us defeated. Because like my husband says, my wonderful, precious husband Scott says, once we're over ourselves and over, because we're on to Satan's lies, we're going to be most effective. And Satan doesn't want that. He wants to keep us ineffective and crippled and deceived. The day has come when his day is over. That's why the world is getting worse. We all think the world's getting worse and worse and worse because Satan is getting... You know why he's getting worse? Because we're coming to the truth. And the church of God is finally going to take its full inheritance and walk in it as a living reality. And his day is over. His day is over. He has ruled and reigned too long in the church of God. And I am telling you, the church of God has had a religious spirit. Praise the Lord. We rebuke that religious spirit to before the whole world. We do. Because what's coming is true spirituality, where Christ can actually reign and live his life freely in man. And we're a living and walking Jesus. Now, don't hear me wrong. I'm not saying that we ever become Jesus. We don't. But he certainly lives in my humanity, expresses his life through me. Somebody said, what do you mean Christ as me? Because you're going to, if you've got my book, you read that all the way through my book. Well, I said, okay, he's in me. He's going to be expressing himself as if he's me. Now, that doesn't mean that I become him. But he certainly, it's like it's me. When he's loving through me, hello, it's like Sylvia loving. But is it? No, it's really him loving through me. But I'm in union with him. So it's as me, as if it's me. But it's not me, but hello. How wonderful for him to express his love nature through me. As me is the little common me. And give mysteries. My son always makes fun of me, and I do this all the time. Sometimes I'll be watching myself. I'm off somewhere else because I'm listening to the spirit of what I'm saying or what the spirit's saying through me. And all of a sudden, I'm cheering myself in what I'm saying. And my son David says, Mom, that's you. And I go, oh, yeah, that's right. Well, you know what? I walk away from here. I don't even know what I've said because the Holy Spirit just takes off. And I have to come back and even realize what I've even said. Sometimes I'll be reading my material. I'm not bragging about myself. I'm telling you what the life of the Holy Spirit in us is like. It's like you're so amazed you can't even believe it. I wrote that? No, I didn't do it. It's he did it. He gets the glory, but it's so fun being a part of that union. It's so wonderful being so one with him that it's as me. Oh my gosh, who am I? I'm just a housewife. Have I had any Bible training? No, not official. I think I've gone to the Seminary of Hard Knocks. Now, I've been there back, and I've been to the Seminary of Romans 7, and I've been delivered from the Romans 7 consciousness of self-effort and the self trying to improve itself. So I've been to that seminary. I think that qualifies me. And I hope that you're qualified the same way. Although I'm not speaking against any biblical training. I want to speak for it. But let's interpret the Bible for what it's really saying and not bring lies to the body of Christ and so that we can't really even know the truth about ourselves and we live defeated. Here I go again preaching. Okay. So we see then. Now, how is it that sin, Satan, dwells in Paul? Good question. The Christian. How can Satan produce sins through Paul, who is indwelt by Christ? Good question. That's probably one of the questions we're going to discuss in our discussion. The human is tripartite, spirit, soul, and body. Christ is one with us in spirit, but Satan can get an advantage in us through the flesh, soul, and body. If we believe his lies of human performance, Romans 7:23, verse 23 says this, another law in my members brings me into bondage in the law of sin in my members. A law or principle or person in my members, body and soul, brings me into bondage. So Satan is not in Paul's spirit, but dwells in my humanity as an adulterous spirit, ruling my flesh as long as I give power to him by believing in my own abilities to perform. That's what gives him power. That is why Paul cries out, how to perform, I find not. Performance-based Righteousness doesn't work. This scripture is the proof. The human doesn't do its own sinning, nor his own righteousness. Another vital point here is that a human doesn't have his own will power. That is interesting, because everyone knows that the human has... That is interesting because everyone thinks that the human has willpower, but no, this verse proves that we don't. The will is present with me, but how to perform I find not. It certainly is true that Paul is saying that the human has a will. That is not even the point. The point is that the human doesn't have the power to fulfill his own will, you see. We humans have the faculty to choose, but we don't have the power behind our choice. What we can do, which Paul doesn't understand at this point, is to will or choose the one with the power to fulfill the Spirit's choice. So I say there is no such thing as willpower. Human will, yes, but the human power is powerless without the Spirit's strength to fulfill it. Therefore, Paul couldn't even will or choose his way out of Romans 7. Well, we're going to continue this. I mean, do we love this? And I always love to just pull every bit of truth I can out of this. And you know what? You're going to find things that I don't see. Isn't that wonderful? Because there's always something new. And you know what? There's always new ways to say it. I love that. I have a friend, Tracy. She has the most profound ways of saying spirit truth. And she doesn't sound the same way that I say it. And I say to her, now, Tracy, don't come around us too much. Because you tend to start saying things just alike when you're around people. I mean, we can't help it. We just kind of mimic each other. Well, the reason I say that is, Tracy, stay away. Because I want you to continue to say the way you say it in the freshness that you say it by the Spirit. And you're going to have your own unique, personal way of giving forth these truths. So I'm so thrilled that there are people that are actually rising up that are wanting to teach this truth. We actually, the body of Christ needs an army of teachers that we can come forth and teach the truth, not to condemn, not to live in blame and spend the rest of our life saying everything that's been wrong. Let's get off that. I have to get off that. We have to get on to what the truth is. God told me years ago, don't major on what's wrong. Major on what is the truth. Speak the truth, and then the lie will untangle itself. But if you get in there and try to untangle all the lies, you're going to get tangled yourself. So stay on the truth. And that's just, you know, what I know to do. So that's what the Spirit has given me, and that's what I pray that you will do as well. So thank you for joining us, and this has been lesson number 9. We'll move right on into lesson number 10 the next time. Thank you. Goodbye.
The more I try, the more I fall. I finally see the writing on the wall. The problem lives in what I see. A separate him outside. Her separate me. In a desert land.